Okay, start off with the students kind of talking about the Patriot Plus, something that they're already familiar with. And we're going to talk about it today in terms of using the computer labs, the carts, all the different devices we have available in the building. And we're going to look at it through the lens of being respectful, responsible, and being role models. As we talk about being respectful, we need to remember that these devices that you're going to be using do not belong to you. They're not there for you to tweak or customize the devices. Anytime you're using it, you should make sure that you are handling the devices with care, that you're plugging in the laptops in the cart after you're using it. Also, something to keep in mind is watch what you're printing. You should not be printing directly from the internet, because oftentimes that will create multiple pages of text. Better yet, copy what the content that you want, paste it into a document, and then go ahead and print it from there. That way, you're really getting what you want and you're not wasting paper, so you're being respectful. Being responsible, you need to make sure, if you're coming in during supervised study, that you have a pass. Again, remember the devices are for school use only. You're not there to play games on them, those types of things. If you do get a device that has damage, you want to make sure that you report that damage as quickly as possible to the teacher in your room. That way, you don't end up getting blamed for damage that happens. Things to look for: keys missing, things broken. We'll have the iPads out. People sometimes think it's fun to mess with that. Nobody should be putting a picture of themselves as a screensaver. So, just being really respectful of the equipment. You will need, we do have the floaters that can be checked out during supervised study. Again, your teacher should have that on the pass if you come down during supervised study. And you'll need to make sure that you use your ID to check it out to you. And lastly, being a role model. When you're using the devices in the classroom, when you're done, you want to make sure that you put them away correctly, nice, neat, and organized, that you straighten the devices. If you're using a cart, that everything's plugged in. And then helping out, delivering and returning carts for your teachers to the computer lab is really a way that you can help us all out. This is something we really want to avoid when we get these kind of tangled messes of cables and cords everywhere. What happens is that we have to take the time to take that all apart and redo it. So if everybody helps out every time they're using the carts and are plugging things in and not letting it get like this, we won't be down devices and we'll be able to keep everybody up and running and using the computers like we want. Now, one of the things that we're going to add this year, and we're going to be talking about throughout the year, is digital citizenship and staying safe online. Now, we're talking about this because of the fact that we are going to be moving to a one-to-one environment. The high schools this year all received Chromebooks. Next year, all the junior highs will, as eighth graders. Next year, going into high school, you'll have a Chromebook that you'll be able to use. So we want to make sure that you are always thinking about how you're behaving online when you are using these devices. So I want you to stop and think for a minute, and think about, if you have a key to your house, why wouldn't you just leave it right next to your door on a string? Why wouldn't you do that? So I want you to turn and talk to the person next to you and think about why that's not a good idea. So at this point, I would give them some time to stop and think, have some conversation, and then bring them back together and get some ideas. Well, this really relates to being safe online. You don't just leave your key hanging outside of your house so anybody can walk in and get into your personal information. So you want to make sure that when you are online that you are not posting that type of personal information: your name, your age, your address, your phone number, your school, because people can track you down. And oftentimes these are not the people you want tracking you down. You want to make sure that you check your safety settings on your computer, that you're not sharing content beyond what you want. So, for example, on Facebook, there's the option to post to the world and post to only friends. You want to make sure that as you're posting things across different social media, that you know who has access to see that kind of information. We also want to make sure that, when you are using passwords for your different accounts, that you do keep them private. Again, you don't hang them out there. You don't put them on a post-it note on a computer or on the top of a binder. And you want to make sure that your password is somewhat unique, that it's something that people are not going to remember. And lastly, you really want to think about what you post or share online. And this really kind of comes into being safe, but also digital citizenship. You want to be respectful of people and not post things that are derogatory or bullying and that kind of stuff. So really think about, is posting this appropriate or not? And if you do that, if you take that time to stop and think about it, I think you're going to find you're going to have a very, you're not going to run into the types of problems that people find themselves in. Even as somebody my age, I see people my age posting things that are just completely inappropriate. They are picking fights over Facebook. It's just really unbelievable how poorly some people, including adults, behave online. So you just really want to be putting that best foot forward. The other thing you need to consider is that what you put out there, everyone can see, and it doesn't go away. You can sit there and try to delete all this and all these different things, but really, once something is out there, it's out there. And we do hear of people who, have posted stuff, in high school or junior high or college, and potential universities look at that, potential employers. And I know it seems like it's far down the road, but even thinking about applying for a job at age 16, if you have content out there that's not appropriate, you may not get that job. So just be thinking about those types of things and how you present yourself online. What we're going to do today is really kind of focus on the password piece. And the reason we are is because we want to make sure that you can access the different systems that you need to be able to get to. Okay, so we want to create passwords that are strong. Now, for our systems here in the district, we really want to be looking at passwords that are at least 8 characters length. They become harder for people to crack, for people to figure out. And if you can use combinations of letters, uppercase, lowercase, embedding numbers and symbols, those types of things, it's always more helpful than just straight words. You want to make sure that you're not using any private information. Because again, so often we hear, again, maybe not as much at your age, but sometimes, teenagers do have identity theft and people do take their information and use it in other ways. So you want to make sure that you're not using any of that private information and that you're not using a password that's easy to guess, like, Patriots or, Huskies or something like that. This is one thing that you can do, to create a memorable but strong password, is you could actually take a sentence, a phrase, a book title, or something, and use that phrase in some way that can help you create a password. So the example here is Monica Green loves to ski and hike at Lake Tahoe. Well, they took the first letters and then added in, for the word two, they put the number two. For and, they put the and sign. For the A, they did the at sign. So kind of be thinking about something that is going to be a little bit more difficult for people to guess, but also something, again, that you can remember. And that's really the key, is being able to remember those passwords. Just in general, in terms of passwords and safety guidelines, you don't want to be sharing your passwords with your friends. Again, people get in, they mess with people's documents. It happens. It seems to be kind of a yearly thing we deal with. If you can, try and change your passwords on a regular basis. Every 6 months, is usually good to kind of mix things up. But in the district, we force a password change for you guys every year at minimum. So keep that in mind. So hopefully you've kind of come up with that password, that unique thing that's at least 8 characters long. Going to go ahead and get logged on. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and get logged on to the computers. So if you remember, your username is the first initial of your first name, first initial of your middle name, and your last name. Okay. Your default password is the word password. Okay. Once you type that in, it's going to force you to change that password. Again, we want to go in. Okay, so I'm gonna do that. Here's an example of what we're talking about. Robert John Smith would be RJ Smith, and it would be an 8-digit password that you, at least an 8-digit password you'll want to create. So we'll give them time to do that. I think one of the things that we could do is then have them go to Chrome and have them click into Canvas and type that same information in, because that's one way to verify that the kids have the right account. Because the kids that have maybe a number at the end or no middle initial, this would help us identify if they have the wrong account. Because if they go into Canvas, they'll see their name. So we have the Canvas piece, all right? And then we have the Infinite Campus. If they haven't been in before, we can have them again open up Chrome. And I think we can spend some time talking about browsers too. That really, let's really start focusing on going into Chrome as your base browser as we move into getting Chromebooks and using the Google applications. This is going to be the best tool. You can use Infinite Campus here. You can use Firefox here. So unless your teacher directs you to go to a different website, let's go ahead and try and stick with using Chrome. And then the last thing, I guess if we have time, we could mention that you all will be getting Google accounts at some point. And once we have those accounts created, we'll be having you come in and set the passwords for those, and providing you additional information on how to use the Google, what we call ecosystem in the district.